Thank you. It has been such a great honor and pleasure to be part of this wonderful community. As you said, I may have missed the NAFPLU experience, but I already enjoy the access to all the Harvard resources, and you may all understand how important this is for every academic during this critical situation, which is, nobody knows how long it's going to last. I feel already grateful for being here with you. I'd like to thank all my colleagues from and my students, ex-students who have joined us today and are going to share with me this journey to ancient Greek myth and literature. It's not going to last more than 30 minutes. I counted several times. So we can start. I'll just upload the presentation, make sure that you all can see what I'm projecting right now.
Yes, it's all coming right through.
So searching for the promised land in Greco-Roman myth and the literature. We'll start from Greece and then move to Rome. According to myth and literary rhetoric, the legitimation of Roman state lay in the legend that Aeneas, following his destiny in the wake of Troy's fall, settled down in Italy after a series of adventures across the Mediterranean. There he was supposed to have founded Lavinium as a political and religious center. From a historical perspective, since the whole region of Latium was originally under Etruscan supremacy, the Romans seem to have appropriated the Trojan myth for themselves as soon as they established their domination of the Latin League in the 5th century BC. All right. It was in the Augustan age, though, that this myth was endorsed with special political significance and made part of their ethnic ideology, thanks mostly to Virgil's Aeneid, the epic which established Aeneas as the leading figure of the proto-Roman history in the role of a profugus, a refugee who became a migrant founder to ensure a better future for himself and his people. Nevertheless, any successful story of immigration, the integration, was not unique in Greco-Roman myth. Already in the Aeneid, actually, the Trojan hero is acquainted with other refugees who had already crossed the Adriatic Sea in search of their own promised land. In his encounter with Evander, for example, an Arcadian settler at the site of Rome, Aeneas finds out that the latter was also driven from his homeland in Peloponnese to Italy, pulsum patria. Later in the epic, the Greek Diomedes is also said to have settled in Apulia in southern Italy after the end of the Trojan War, where he founded several cities, among which most known is the Arpi. A peaceful settler in his post-Homeric career, Diomedes declines the local Rutulians' request to undertake a war against Aeneas, thereby promoting the idea of cultural integration, an idea that was particularly cherished in the Augustan age when the Aeneid was written. Above all, though, it is the story of Dido, Aeneas' love affair, which suggests another foundation myth. Having settled in the shores of West North Africa, where she founded Carthage, Dido is moved as she is listening to the story of Aeneas and his companions, since she was also forced to abandon her land, the Phoenician city of Tyre, in order to flee the tyranny of her brother Pygmalion. If we further recollect the mythic origins of other city-states, such as Thebes or Kyrene in Libya, founded by refugees like Cadmus and Batos, we then realize that in the Greco-Roman world, migrant founders and not autochthonous or aboriginal people were commonly found in the core of a community's origins as founders, as civilizers, and leaders. However, as I will try to showcase, the Romans rather than the Greeks were those who mostly embraced such stories. This becomes particularly evident if we cast light on one of the most neglected foundation myths in the classical tradition, so as to contextualize it with the political, ethnic, and literary representation of Rome as a community largely built by refugees. I use the word neglected because if compared to other more celebrated refugees mentioned above, the name of Teucer, Tephros in modern Greek, sounds quite unfamiliar. There he is. This is perhaps because the son of King Telamos of Salamis, somehow, a tiny Greek island nearby Athens, mostly known for the famous naval battle between the Greek and the Persian fleet, he was somehow overshadowed by the figure of his famous father, Telamon, and especially by that of his half-brother, Ajax. The first owes his reputation to his involvement in the Argonautic expedition, while he features in all versions of Hercules' sacking of Troy. It was in honor of his contribution to Hercules' feat, indeed, that Telamon took as a prize the daughter of King Laomedon, Isione, the woman who bore him Teucer. As for Ajax, you all know him, the bulwark of the Achaeans, whose might and colossal figure are proverbial in Homer's Iliad, he is also known from Sophocles' play, which recounts the aftermath of his suicide after his failure to be awarded with the armor of Achilles. We'll get back to this play shortly. In contrast, for most Greek authors, Teucer, despite his other qualities as a hero, he is an orphos, a bastard son of a slave woman, due to his mother's Trojan origins, already evident from his very name. In the Iliad, he is presented as an efficient killer by virtue of his excellence in archery. Homer supplies a list of his victims in Book 8, while the hero's best moment, the kind of aristeia, appears in Book 15, where he twice attempts to kill Hector as the latter is driving back the Achaeans towards their ships. His heroic status, though, is constantly undermined by the fact that in most of battle scenes, Teucer is fighting under the protection of Ajax, as we frequently find him loosening his shafts from behind his half-brother's enormous shield. Consider, for example, the passage in the slide. Teucer's fighting tactic is somewhat cunning, as the use of the concomitant verbs dusken and kryptaske indicates. Shooting his arrows from behind the megasacos of Ajax, he returns to the safety of his brother's shield once he has hit a rival. Homer's likening him to a child always looking for his mother's arms is very apt and telling indeed, but at the same time, it appears to detract from Teucer's heroism, pointing to his disproportionate relationship with his brother, if we can call it like that. Even more, by hiding himself behind Ajax's shield, a weapon that identifies his brother par excellence in the Iliad, Teucer is figuratively losing his identity and autonomy as an epic hero, being overshadowed by Ajax's dominant figure. This sentiment is further detectable even in Agamemnon's compliment to him for his successful performance, which brings us to the next slide. Agamemnon's somewhat derogatory tone in the abstract you see was enough to make the Alexandrian scholiasts omit line 284 on scope of the exhortation. Nevertheless, Agamemnon's words still bear some unfavorable connotations in terms of Teucer's parentage. By asking him to become a light that brings glory to his father and the Greek warriors, Agamemnon is essentially urging him to come out of the shadows in which his illegitimate parentage resides and fight for his self-identification. Now, the idea that Teucer's illegitimacy is structurally important, as a modern commentator says, for the definition of his relationship, both to his brother and his father, also pervades the Ajax of Sophocles. Next slide. In this play, Teucer is confronted with the humiliating conduct again of Agamemnon, and this time also by his brother, Menelaus, who demand that the corpse of his dishonored brother be left unburied. Expressing his determination to fulfill his brother's last request before his suicide, Teucer is first mocked by Menelaus of being overconfident, and later by Agamemnon, who calls him the son of a slave mother and makes fun of his barbarian accent. That's why I sympathized with Teucer so much because of my own barbarian accent in English. Anyway, on top of this abuse, Agamemnon argues that Teucer, being nothing himself, is hopelessly trying to defend someone who is nothing now, line 1231. By coupling him, a living person, with his dead brother and describing both men as non-entities, Agamemnon expands on Teucer's insignificance in the most humiliating manner. In doing so, the Mycenaean king appears to epitomize all the Greek literary tradition that treats Teucer as nothing more than a bastard archer who owes his standing to his father's name and his brother's martial valor. Actually, even Teucer, this tragedy, exhibits a kind of self-awareness in terms of his reception in Greek myth and literature, and the reflection on his banishment when he alone predicts, with a touch of irony, that his father Telamon will be the one who will reject him for his failure to return home with his brother. Let's see, next slide. In Teucer's imagination, Telamon will not just blame him for being a coward, but he will further suspect him of treachery, assuming that he has forsaken his brother's life and honor so as to become the sole heir to the throne. This is the first time the strong bond between the two brothers, as exemplified so far in their common fights in the battlefield, is weakened, and devious motives are attributed to Teucer's intentions. Most significantly, for all the implications regarding Teucer's illegitimacy, the outright insults endorsed in this play, it is his father Telamon who calls him an Othos, a bastard, on the grounds of his disloyalty and the violation of his close relationship with his brother. By the end of this tragedy, Teucer will have managed to respond more or less convincingly to all the challenges set to him. However, we must remember that he is granted the permission to make arrangements for his brother's burial only after the intervention of Odysseus, who is the one who finally persuades Agamemnon to allow Ajax a proper burial.
Ajax, Ajax, Oeadas.
As for Teucer's own reward, his post-Trojan war fate and the misery of his exile, these are all left to the audience's imagination as an open, unresolved issue. It is Ajax's honor that is restored in Sophocles' play not Teucer's ill fame. The latter must still fight for his survival and his self-vindication. Unfortunately, for the rest of the tragedies that have been handed down to us, we cannot have a precise idea of how his struggle played out. To our surprise, Teucer appears only in Euripides' Helen, playing the part of an informant who tells the heroine about the aftermath of the war at Troy and the homecoming of the Greek warriors. For our purposes, it is important to know that his status, as we have traced it so far, remains rather unchanged. Answering Helen's persistent questions, in her excitement to have found someone who has returned from Troy, he introduces himself as a Greek who has been banished from his homeland. Being an exile too, Helen shows her sympathy and wants to learn more about his drama. Teucer's responses, however, are consciously terse and quite vague, especially in terms of his father's decision to banish him, line 92, and the reason for his disgrace, line 94. As for his illegitimacy, this seems to be discreetly absorbed by his other misfortunes. Overall, he appears quite reluctant to speak more of his traumatic past and relates only what is absolutely necessary about the fate of Helen's husband and her family members. His presence in the play, however, is better understood on a symbolic level. As Helen confesses, she has also suffered unjustly as a result of her complicated parentage and identity, while she has also been falsely accused of treachery and sent into exile. This is why the two characters take a step nearer to each other at the end of their dialogue, which when Teucer finally tells Helen about his quest, pleading for her help. In his determination to move past the casualties and misfortunes of the Trojan War, Teucer brings Helen's inquiries to an abrupt end, as his absolute priority is to continue his journey to the land where Apollo has promised him a new home. It should be noted that the passage you see, to my knowledge, is the only existing passage in Greek literature, apart from a couple of lines in Pindar, where the prospect of the foundation of a new Salamis in Cyprus is mentioned. In contrast to the audience's expectations, however, Helen's feedback, despite her assurance that his journey will signal all that he needs to know, line 151, is somehow vague, if not confusing, as it provides no clear sign that Teucer will eventually be rewarded for his sufferings. We may understand that he will eventually reach Cyprus, as long as this is something ordained by Apollo's oracle, but his social and ethical rehabilitation remains uncertain as in Sophocles, actually. Contrary to the Greek tragedians, Teucer's drama was more cherished among the Roman playwrights and their audiences. It appears that the Romans had their own reasons to favor a Teucer written by Pacuvius. Since Cicero cites several verses from this lost play in his work, it must be said beforehand that in none of these fragments do we find any reference, no matter how oblique, to Teucer's illegitimacy. Actually, the most celebrated line of Pacuvius' play must have been one that Cicero recalls in his Dusculan Disputations: to deprecate the evils of exile. This is a wonderful passage. There we are. patria est ubicumque est bene. This neat verse must have inspired the Roman audience with sentiments of hope and courage that are all missing from the Greek versions of the myth. In the context of Cicero's treatise, it is adduced as a sententia to illustrate the Stoic doctrine that virtue alone is sufficient for happiness under any circumstances, among which exile was regarded by the Romans as one of the most appalling. However, there is no question that Chaucer was mostly celebrated as a homeless wanderer in Augustan literature. In the Aeneid, Virgil reincarnates him in the role of an informant from whom Dido claims to have first heard about the misfortunes of the Trojans. Virgil, we must say, adds another critical chapter to Teucer's wanderings, as from Dido's account of her encounter with him, we learn that after his exile, he took refuge in Sidon, where he joined her father's successful campaign against Cyprus. Like Helen, however, Dido is touched too by Teucer's story, since she was also forced to abandon her homeland in search of a new patria. For the Roman audience, though, it is the wider applicability of Teucer's toils to Aeneas' cause, as the Salaminian warrior represents a fine example of how a homeless refugee manages to gain a new kingdom. By telling his story, therefore, Dido serves a dual purpose. Not only does she display her kinship to the Trojans through her father's guest friendship with Teucer, but she is implicitly offering Aeneas a new home like her father did to Teucer. In this instance, the issue of Teucer's descent is no longer a taboo, either for himself or for those who surround him, as Dido remembers him speaking proudly of his Trojan origins. Projected as a proto-founder and proto-Aeneas, the Salaminian exile serves the politics of the Aegean, of the Aeneid in a discreet but highly symbolic way. And this is more than enough to earn him a totally sympathetic look in Virgil's epic, which is based also on a foundation myth. However, Teucer's complete rehabilitation in Roman letters is mostly achieved by Horace in Carmen 1:7. An ode otherwise considered one of the most problematic pieces of his lyric collection due to its complex structure and its generic pluralism. The ode's dramatic setting is basically a symbiotic one. An after-dinner conversation takes place between Horace and his friend Plancus, a noble statesman, who grumbles because his military obligations keep him away from his residence in Tibur, a beauty spot that exceeds all those mentioned in Horace's opening preamble. In his consolation, the lyric Sapiens exhorts Plancus to put always an end to his misery with wine in whatever place he finds himself. In addition, Horace, like Cicero, applies the mythological example of Teucer in the remainder of the poem to enhance this point further. As we may guess, most readings of the lines you see and Teucer's exhortation that culminates in lines 25 to 31 focus on the well-attested correspondence of his speech with those of Aeneas and Ulysses, who rally their men in a similar way in the Aeneid and the Odyssey, respectively. The two passages which make up the most important parallels read as follows. Next slide. All right. The verbal similarities between the two Latin texts through their Greek source are too many to be reproduced here. For your convenience, I have marked them in blue. Consider, for example, Soki, and Philoi. But the ultimate result of this triple interaction has made most readers switch to Virgil as the one who paved the way to the insertion of Teucer's myth in Horace's Ode. As already seen, it was Virgil who first connected Aeneas with Teucer as survivors of the Trojan War and post-war vagrants, who eventually are given the chance by the same people, Dido and her father, to get over their past misfortunes. Now, if we turn to Horace again, we shall see that he not only complements Virgil's version, but he recuperates Teucer as an archetypal founder by making him more optimistic, more confident, and more committed to his purpose. Seeking to reassure his despairing fellows, the lyric Teucer retrieves Apollo's oracle from the domain of Greek tragedy, as we have just seen it in Euripides' Helen. Thus, the foundation of a new Salamis, which in Greek literature remains in question more or less, is finally put forward in a mostly straightforward manner. Certus enim promisit Apollo, and etc. From this aspect, the metaphor crass ingens interabimus aequor, that prominently encapsulates Teucer's imminent departure, communicates a certainty that is missing in the abstract of the Odyssey, and is also and comes in stark contrast to its parallel that concludes Aeneas' speech. While the Trojan hero, being sick with enormous cares, finds hope with his face and suppresses his grief deep in his heart, Horace's Teucer is more poised and determined than any literary or mythological foil to become a founder. To sum up, the Roman Teucer is a wholly remodeled and recuperated hero from Greek myth and the literature. Not only is he no more overshadowed by his brother Ajax, but he also doesn't need to apologize either for his illegitimate parentage or his failure to match his father's excellence and back up Ajax. All the above belong to his Greek past, a past that was gradually erased from all Roman literary records. In Roman drama and epic, the hero is purged of any unpleasant associations. As is often the case, when Augustan poets reject a particular genre or theme, this recusatio of Teucer's past carries both a political and a literary message as well. His appropriation in Latin poetry demanded his transformation from a bastard archer into a noble founder, a man with a sense of purpose and honor, an exemplary hero who is used as a paradigm to Aeneas. Nevertheless, his portrait always obeys to the ethics or the generic rules of the text that incorporate him and advertise him to the Roman readers. If for Pacuvius, Teucer was an emblematic exponent of the freedom in exile creed, and for Cicero, an exemplar of the Stoic doctrine that virtue can be achieved in every situation, in Virgil's Aeneid, this minor figure of Greek myth is transformed into an Odysseus plus, a warrior and a wanderer, and a promising colonist. That is a proto-Aeneas. In metapoetic terms, like Diomedes, Teucer inhabits a less archaic more human, and morally more balanced epic war. That is a modern epic, which is more about loss, exile, restoration, and less about revenge and sin. Finally, Horace Stusser meets the highest standards in all aspects of his multi-layer career. Plus, he's an occasional drinker for the needs of the poet's occasional lyrics. Even as a drinker, though, he personifies freedom and hope and the tranquility of mind, establishing himself as a lifelong paradigm for all Roman and modern readers against all the fortunes of life. Thank you.